Pandas. Hello, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us today at World Wildlife Fund's Pandas and Prose event, our monthly conversation with notable writers who use nature and the written word to inspire and educate readers around the world. So welcome wherever you are in the world, on the West Coast or on the East Coast in the United States, if you're having your breakfast or a lunch break. Thank you so much for tuning in today. My name is Jenna Bonello, and I will be your host. Before we begin, I just wanted to go over a few logistics for the event today. This is a webinar, which means your cameras and audios have been turned off, but you're able to ask questions via the chat feature. So please use that throughout, and certainly once we get to the audience Q&A portion of the program. This event is being recorded, and there will also be closed captions. And so without further ado, the two people who you came for. I am joined today by Loren Mayor, World Wildlife Fund's Chief Operating Officer. Loren brings immense operational experience with networked organization in the fields of strategy consulting, performing arts, and journalism to her role at World Wildlife Fund. Most recently, Loren was president of operations at NPR, where she oversaw the full suite of operational operations, including programming, member partnership, policy and representation, IT, engineering and distribution, business development, HR, legal, and diversity teams. In that capacity, Loren led NPR in identifying new business opportunities, developing NPR's strategic plan, and building a strong, empowering culture, which she also does at WWF. Before NPR, Loren held leadership roles at PBS, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and worked with clients in the nonprofit and media sectors during her tenure at McKinsey and Company. Loren has an undergraduate degree from the University of Chicago and a Ph.D. in theater from Northwestern University, where she also served as a visiting assistant professor. So welcome to Loren. And we are so thrilled to have Morgan Harper Nichols here with us today, a popular Instagram poet and artist who created her life's work around the stories of others. I am such a personal fan and so honored that she's here with us. Morgan's Instagram feed, which you can follow at Morgan Harper Nichols, has garnered a loyal online community, and she is the author of All Along You Are Blooming, her first book of poems and art she created in response to the personal stories submitted by her friends and followers just like you. Known for its lyrical tone and vibrant imagery, Morgan's work is an organic expression of the grace and hope we've been given in this world. Morgan has also performed as a vocalist on several Grammy-nominated projects and written for various artists, including a Billboard number one single performed by her sister, Jamie Grace. Morgan is often on the road creating, teaching, performing, in hopes of spreading her unique inspirational message and inviting others into her creative process. Morgan currently is in Phoenix, Arizona with her family. So Loren has a few questions herself for Morgan about her newest collection of poetry, How Far You Have Come, Musings on Beauty and Courage, that will guide the first part of this discussion, and then we'll open it up for audience Q&A. So again, please use the chat feature throughout, we'll be monitoring. So thank you so much, Loren, and welcome Morgan, and Loren, over to you.
Thank you for having me. I'm so honored to be here.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Jenna and Morgan. We're so excited to have you here. You are our first poet as part of the Panda and Prose series. Before we dive in, we've been asking this question of everybody as we get started, given what a crazy time this is. Just where are you in the world and how have you been spending your time?
Oh, yes. So I am in Phoenix, Arizona area, and I have been spending a lot of time at home. I'm the parent of a 2-year-old, and my spouse is also my business partner. So we all just work together, are at home a lot. You know, the days kind of run together every few days. But it's ultimately, I consider myself, you know, enormously privileged that I do get to work at home. I am regularly just thinking about and talking to people who are essential workers, who are out there more. And for me, I'm just like, okay, I recognize it as a privilege, and I'm super grateful that I do get to be at home and be able to work on books and do work that I love. So with all that considered, yeah, I've been keeping pretty busy, but in the same place. So that's just like an interesting thing. But I'm reading a lot more. I've gotten a lot more books this past year. And yeah, so that's a little bit of where I've been and what I've been up to.
That's terrific. I think many of us can relate to that. I feel like my whole world has somehow shrunk to the size of about this Zoom screen.
Yeah. Yes. And it's still simultaneously like busy and active. So yes. Indeed.
Well, let's talk about your book. I'm going to show it to you. Just if you haven't read this book, it is really, it's more like a work of art. It's just, it's full of handwritten poems, beautiful artwork, typeset poetry, essays. I know you must get this all the time, but I feel like I know you because I've read this book. So I wanted to just start a little with the structure. Each chapter is named after a state. How did you think about the structure of this book?
Yeah, so I actually started with the cover of the book, which is an iPhone photo that I took in Albuquerque, New Mexico, leaving Albuquerque, New Mexico one morning. And it's one of those photos on my phone that I have saved in my favorites because it's just like a favorite photo that I've taken. And I knew I had this opportunity to write a new book. However, the lockdown had just started and there was no way of kind of like going out in the world and being inspired. And, you know, those are and still are incredibly uncertain times. And I was like, how do you write for a future where you don't even know what tomorrow is going to be like, where, you know, the news is changing every hour, it seems. So I was like, well, I can look back. So I started with looking back literally at iPhone photos from my phone. And I landed on that photo and I was like, isn't it interesting how this photo to me represents so much beauty and so much of what I love about life, about creativity and traveling. And yeah, internally, I was really struggling a lot at that time in my life, especially financially. I was just in a really uncertain, stressful, anxious place. And that actually made me think about, you know what? There's probably other places on the map where I have been somewhere where aesthetically, externally, it was beautiful. It was speaking to me, but internally I was growing in courage in some way. So I was like, yeah, I'm going to look at some actual road trips that I've taken in my life. And that led me to where I grew up in Atlanta, Georgia. And that was like a really like defining road trip for me and my whole life. And that ended up taking me through 8 different states, 8 different landscapes. And yeah, I ended up with this book that I share way more about myself than I've ever shared. There's quite a few stories in there. I'm like, I can't believe I put this in the book, but it just had to happen. And I just hope that other people can, it helps other people see like the beauty of their own journeys. So, yeah.
Thank you. Maybe we can talk about one of those moments in the book. I was really struck in here. You talk about one of the first, I think, main posts that you wrote that really took off and set you on this current path. If you don't mind, maybe I'll read that post. And then if you could tell us a little bit about where you were and where this took you, I think that would be great. So what you wrote was, when you start to feel like things should have been better this year, remember the mountains and valleys that brought you here. They were not mistakes, and those moments were not in vain. You are not the same. You have grown and you are growing. You are living, you are breathing. You are wrapped in endless, boundless grace, and things will get better. There is more to you than yesterday.
Yes. Oh, thank you for reading that back to me. Every time I hear that poem, it takes me back to the moment that I wrote it, which was a time of great uncertainty in my life. I feel like a lot of the huge uncertain moments in my life, like, have had to do with finances or lack thereof. But that was another time in my life where I was just like, what are we going to do? My husband, Patrick, and I, like, we were kind of doing a lot of different freelance work. And we were loving what we did, but we were very paycheck to paycheck. And I was just kind of asking this question of like, is it always going to be this way? Am I always going to be worried? And with that also came this feeling of letting other people down. I felt like by not being successful, I felt like what I was defining as successful, I felt like I let my family down. I have a very supportive family. And I was like, oh my gosh, like, all these people have believed in me. And here I am struggling to make it through. And I just kind of broke down and cried it out. And for whatever reason, at the edge of those tears, I was like writing these words all of a sudden. And I wrote about that because I know that I'm not the only person who has dealt with that kind of uncertainty. Is it always going to be this way? And I just think about how it's so interesting to hear that poem all 6 years after I wrote it, and 5 years after I wrote it. And I'm like, yeah, that still applies. It's so easy to look back and feel like we haven't done what we're supposed to do in life. But at the same time, it's like, if you just look at it from a practical standpoint of the actual literal miles that we've traveled in our life, it's like, we've all come so far. It's like, even if you've only ever lived within like a 5 mile radius of the same area, the amount of times you left your house and come back, like, we've all traveled so many miles. So yeah, I think that poem is just how I was slowly but surely learning how to say that to myself. And yeah, it just came out in the form of a poem.
Do you have a sense of why it is connected with so many people?
You know, I was originally kind of shocked at the response of that poem. I mean, it ended up getting shared quite a bit. And that is honestly what started this whole thing of what I do. And I think, and this wasn't my intention, but I think this is what happened. Because I didn't necessarily talk about like the specifics of what I was going through. Like, I mean, this was like a career failure, financial thing. Like, that's what the stress was. But because for whatever reason, it came out metaphorically, talking about nature, talking about mountains and valleys, I think it became more universal. And that other people could think about their own mountains and valleys in their life. I don't think I realized it when I was writing it, but I am so deeply interested in what connects us and what connects us as human beings. And there's a lot we don't know. There's a lot we can't seem to agree on, but it's like, well, we can see that mountains, we can see valleys. So let's just start there and see if that can kind of foster a sense of vulnerability and connection. So I think that's what happened. I wasn't trying to do it that way, but I do think nature can be universal, and we can see how it connects us to others and also to our own stories. So yeah.
You write at the end of that paragraph, I write to connect because I know in my core, we are all more alike than different.
Yes, really. I believe that wholeheartedly.
You do use a whole lot of nature in this book. And I just wondered if you could speak to what do you see as the power of nature? How has it influenced the way that you work?
Yeah, so I could talk about this forever. So I'm like, okay, Morgan, narrow it down. But a lot of it comes back to childhood for me. I just felt so at peace in nature. I was fortunate enough growing up in Georgia that like we had a backyard with these big trees. And to me, it was enough to just stand there and just be. And unfortunately, I didn't feel that way in other areas of my life. I now know that I'm autistic. I didn't know that as a child. So I was struggling with dealing with undiagnosed autism my whole life. So there was actually an explanation for why I felt so overwhelmed and overstimulated and not able to keep up in the, you know, real world, quote unquote. So for me, nature became that place of refuge, and it became that place of I don't have to like be on out here. I can just be. It's like, you know, there's a squirrel walking by me, and yeah, that squirrel's minding their business and I'm minding mine. Like it's just, we could just be out here together. And I have so many memories of just like watching the birds just fly from tree to tree. And again, watching those squirrels, like, I don't know why the squirrels never pay me any mind. Like I think my mom has stories of like squirrels, like walking up to her. No, they never did. they were interested in having that kind of connection. So I've just kind of observed and watched from afar. And I remember those moments very clearly. So I think as I got older, it was just like, there's something to that. Like, I think there's something to like these small, beautiful things that we remember. So in many ways, I just feel like I'm just kind of nurturing that part of myself, because I still need it today. And it gets even harder to remember the older I've gotten and the busier life has gotten, of like, hey, you can take 5 minutes to just go outside and stare at the tree. Like, you don't have to have permission to do that. Just get out there and just be there. So painting all these trees and flowers and rivers helps keep me kind of coming back to that place.
Do you have a favorite place or a favorite landscape?
Oh my goodness. That's such a good question. You know, I think it's the desert. I think it's the desert. I love the openness and being able to see the horizon. And if I'm ever doing like a meditation or something, or like think of a place that you, it's always the desert. I don't know why. It's always just the openness, that open space. And I love to paint the sunset colors. I have so many pictures of sunsets on my phone. Like it's just, it's just pictures of like my son and like sunsets, my son and sunset. That's kind of it. But I think that's it. But it may change throughout life, you know, it may change. But right now, I think it's the desert.
Thank you. Can I ask a different nature-related question? And this one is not exactly about the book, but I, like almost 2 million other people, follow you on Instagram. And you had this amazing image of a tiger just recently. Here at WWF, we care a whole lot about tigers. We have a whole initiative, T2, dedicated to doubling the population of tigers by 2022. And under this picture, you wrote, "May we never forget our strength. May we never forget strength comes in many shapes." And I just wonder if you could talk to us a little bit about that post, what led to it, and what you were thinking.
Oh, yes, absolutely. So for whatever reason, I just kept having this visual of a tiger in my head for several days. And I was like, where's this coming from? I hadn't watched anything about tigers recently. And it just kept coming to mind. And I feel like kind of like my thinking mind was like, okay, there's some deep meaning here. And I was like, what is it? What is it? And then for whatever reason, I was able to say, just forget that. Like, you like to draw, and drawing brings me a lot of peace and joy. So let's just draw a tiger and let's just see what happens. So I ended up looking at tons of reference photos of tigers and just playing with sketching. And eventually I saw it come to life and I was really proud of it. And it just spoke to me. And it was one of those images where I was like, there's something about this tiger that even if no one else saw this image, like it's speaking to me and I feel connected to it. But as I started to kind of like finish the piece, I started to really think about why is this connecting with me? And why did I paint this tiger making like this very clear eye contact, like looking straight ahead? Like, why am I drawn to that? And I was like, to me, this symbolizes strength. And as an autistic person, eye contact is actually very hard for me. So for me, making eye contact is a sign of strength. And that made me think about, I'm like, wow, that's so small in the grand scheme of things, but that's still strength. And even this tiger in this moment of stillness, that's still strength. Even though it's just a photo, that's still strength. And that's worth acknowledging and celebrating. So for me, just even as I've learned even more about what you all are doing on behalf of the tigers, it is very, for me, it became a very symbolic moment of like, even when we're not seeing someone or a tiger at their strongest, you know, like in action, like doing their thing, it's like, that's still a moment of strength. And like, that's still something worth honoring, preserving, celebrating. And it's beautiful on a natural level and also a spiritual level. And it's just, yeah, it's just something I want to spend more time with. And I'm really proud of that image. And I've gotten so much connection just from even looking at it, if that's not weird to say, but yeah.
I feel like it speaks to us too, in this COVID moment, right? Where we are all a little stiller than mm-hmm. we might have been. We're not on planes. We're not out there moving. And yet mm-hmm. we have to find that.
Yeah. And it's interesting too, with like, I always like to encourage people to like, even if you feel like you're the worst at drawing, like I encourage people to try sketching, because it's such an interesting thing. You're forced to sit there with the still image, the stillness, and feel the aliveness in it. And that's what I experienced in drawing that tiger, was just like, wow, there's so much speaking to me, even though this is just a static image. So, yeah.
Thank you. You've mentioned your autism a couple of times. I'm just curious, how do you think it has shaped you as a person and as an artist?
Yeah, so I was diagnosed earlier this year after discovering some videos on TikTok, actually. I heard some stories of young women who were talking about being diagnosed as an adult. And as they were describing their experiences and what their life was like, I was like, this sounds like me. So I actually started to Google around, and I ended up finding a specialist. And it has honestly brought me so much relief just to have a name for what I've been struggling with my whole life. I had someone reach out after I shared my diagnosis that knows me personally, like outside of what I do. And they were like, I'm so sorry. And I'm like, this is nothing to be sorry about. I've always struggled with this. And now I have a name where I can get support. And it's given me a great deal of confidence, I would even say, in learning how to embrace myself. There are parts of myself that I don't even like to share professionally, because I'm like, oh, that might be perceived as too weird or too off kilter or whatever. And it's making me gently question a lot of those things and say, or maybe this is just a part of who you are. Just own it. It's like, I feel like talking about tigers today, so I'm going to. I had a similar moment like that with hummingbirds not too long ago, and I've just started to allow myself, both personally and professionally, to not filter myself so much and not feel like I have to hold parts of myself back, because I feel like it'll make me too different. And I'm just, you know, I'm 31 years old, and I'm glad to be having that moment now. That's something that like 15-year-old Morgan, like 25-year-old Morgan really, really needed to hear. So I'm just so grateful. I mean, of course, being autistic comes with many challenges, but it for me, I'm so grateful to be able to see the gifts. And it's brought a lot of positive change to be able to have the support now, to be able to have a name for what I've been dealing with.
Thank you for sharing that. I think that's a really important lesson for all of us, right? That to just embrace who we are. Yes. And not feel like we have to censor it all the time. Mm-hmm. I have to ask, tell us about hummingbirds.
Oh, yes. Well, there is this one specific hummingbird that I'd never seen before. And I don't even know how I found it, but now I'm nervous. I'm saying the name wrong, but I think it's the black-throated mango hummingbird.
It's possible somebody watching will know the
okay,
answer.
Yeah, it's a very specific name. This is a beautiful hummingbird. I mean, the colors, I literally, so I'm working on like a big iMac. I downloaded like 10 pictures and made them like high resolution and just stared. I'm like, how is it possible that these many colors can be on this tiny little animal? And they're all so vivid. And I did paint them, but I don't feel like my painting did enough justice. But yeah, I am waiting to the day that hopefully that hummingbird crosses my path. It may not. I think it's in like a tropical rural area that I may never get to visit. But I love that hummingbird. So, so beautiful. And yeah, I can see the colors in my mind. So I highly recommend everyone Google that. Hopefully I said that right. The black throat mango hummingbird. Yes.
Thank you for sharing that. Speaking about painting, just reminded me, so this book is full of poems and they are moving and meaningful. But there's one of them that just made me laugh right out loud. And it said, some days we're the painter, some days we're the paint. Yes. Beautiful things are being made all the same. And I wonder, do you remember what you were thinking about when you wrote that?
Oh my goodness. Yes, yes. So I spent a lot of time painting. And I regularly have these like meta moments where it's like, what am I doing? You know, am I like creating something new or am I just contributing to something that already was? I'm not the first person to paint this shade of yellow, but maybe I'm the first person to paint it in this shape, or maybe I'm not. So tons of overthinking. And that was just really kind of like a note to self, you know, as I'm putting these paintings in a book out in the world of like, hey, just let it be what it needs to be. Like some days you're going to feel like an artist and some days you're not. Sometimes you're going to feel like that paint just kind of splattered on the page, running all over the place, and you don't know what's going to come of it. So yeah, that is where that came from. So I'm glad that made you laugh, because that definitely is me kind of like learning how to not take myself so seriously and not overthink every little thing.
There are definitely days I totally feel like the paint. Yes. But turning from that really to your creative process, you know, I was so curious as I was reading it and knowing I was going to get to talk to you. How do you decide, right? How do you decide what's going to be a handwritten poem? How do you decide? Yeah. How did you put this together?
Oh, yes. Yes. So I am a very visual person. I see lots of images. I look at lots of images, photographs all the time. I'll even watch movies just for aesthetic purposes. I'm like, sorry, I wasn't even paying attention to the plot. I just love the animation. I'll have to watch it again to get the plot. So I just love taking art in. And what I've discovered in, because I'm not a professionally trained artist or anything. I mean, I literally have an iPad and I watch YouTube and Skillshare videos. And that's kind of how I've made up my art. But what I found is kind of like what I was talking about with the tiger, is like, give myself permission to just sit with the image and see what kind of naturally comes up from that. So sometimes I'll just start painting the color blue. And then I'm like, all I'm getting from this is the word breathe. But sometimes I get a whole paragraph or two. So that's kind of where that comes together. And for the book, I actually started with every single section is, because I do overthink it. And I was like, I don't know what's going to go where, like what images need to be there. So I was like, let me start with the color that I felt in that particular place. And there's no like real logical reasoning behind it. But for Louisiana, it was purple. So I didn't know where to go at first with Louisiana. But I was like, when I feel that story, it feels purple to me. For Arizona, it just felt orange. For Texas, it just felt kind of greenish yellow. So I start with that and I literally would start painting a whole page of that color. And then I'm like, what is that color? Oh, I'm thinking of a purple guitar. I'm thinking of a purplish sunset. And from there, that's where I actually start to find the poetry. I think of it kind of like finding the poetry in the art. Very rarely do I have moments where I sit down at a blank piece of paper and the poem just comes. I admire those who can do that, but art is very much so a part of the process of bringing the words to life. And I compare it to kind of like how living is what helps us find the language for life. It's you don't really know how you, what words you have for certain things until you've experienced it and you lived it. And then later on, you find the language for it. So I see poetry as very similar of like having something that you can kind of busy yourself with your hands. And for me, that's painting. And then the poetry kind of rises up for that, from that. And when it comes to the which poems are handwritten and which ones are typed, that just has to do with how many words there are. So the longer the poem, I'm like, yeah, I'm not lettering all that. Like, that's just going to get a bit too confusing. Let's just type that one out. So yeah, that part of it, I think it's just more practical, I guess.
So interesting. I know you're a musician too. Do you feel like there's a parallel process for you when you think about music versus poetry?
Oh, music is just like another monster all the way over there. It is such a mystery to me, because one, I'm not one of those musicians who, my sister, who's a musician, is this way. She just kind of gets melodies throughout the day. They just kind of find her. She's like, oh, a melody. That doesn't happen to me. Whoever the melody muses are, they don't send them, they don't come my way. I don't get those. For me, music comes from looking at things I've written through my kind of poetry process, writing process. And then I do play guitar, I do play piano, and it takes me weeks, months, sometimes years to put songs together. That process of melody and lyrics. And that's where my sister, who is more melody focused, that's where she comes in. We actually work together a lot. I'm like, okay, I've got these words. And she'll just come up with a melody out of thin air. I'm like, I don't have that skill. I wish I did. Yeah, I love experimenting with music, but it is definitely a great mystery for sure.
Well, you are an amazingly creative person in so many ways, and apparently the whole family. Oh, yeah.
Yes, very creative family. Thank you.
I'm wondering what you hope people get out of reading your poems.
I really hope that. And there's a reason why I'm drawn to simplicity in my poetry and conversational tone, is that I hope that it helps people find the poetry in their own life, and the conversations that they're having with their friends, their family, or with themselves, to help others find poetry in the pages of their own journal, whether they share it or not. I think that poetry is woven through everyone's life, and I have found so much joy in finding it in my own life. And I just want other people to have that experience too, because I think it's really special, especially in uncertain times. I think it's incredibly beautiful to have those poetic moments in life. So yeah, I just hope that my work helps other people find that in their life.
Thank you for that. I really think it does. I see Jenna here, so I assume we are going to turn to some audience questions.
Hi, sorry awesome. To interrupt, but you know, we've been getting a lot of audience questions, and just you know, thank you so much, Morgan, for these just honest and beautiful answers. You know, I know you haven't been paying attention to the chat, but throughout, you know, Elizabeth just says thank you, certainly sharing your autism diagnosis. Donna also just says you're amazing. So this has been such a beautiful conversation. But yeah, I think we'll dive right in to get a couple audience questions before we have to go this morning or this afternoon. The first one is from Bex, and she asks, since COVID-19 and more time at home, I've found myself even more connected to nature and find myself outdoors more often. I actually know Bex, and I know she's been doing a lot of fishing. But so has a similar thing happened to you and your family? And Loren, this question could also be for you. You know, I think too, and also has, if that has being outside in nature transformed you at all? You know, I know that that's a big theme, certainly in your newest book. So yeah, what has sort of COVID-19 brought to light for you that wasn't there before?
Yeah, well, I can answer and say that, yeah, I totally agree with you, Bex. Very same feeling. I think it's taught me to embrace the simplicity of what nature can bring. I'm a person who loves the Grand Canyon. It's my favorite place on earth. I haven't been in forever. I haven't been to any big natural landmark in a very long time, and I'm desperately craving that. So this past year has taught me how to approach the tree outside my window with the same curiosity and wonder that I would at, you know, a more well-known place. And even for somebody who loves making art in nature, that's very hard for me. I love taking pictures. I'm like, how many more pictures can I possibly take of this pine tree in the backyard? Like it's evergreen. It doesn't even like change leaves. But yeah, for me, that's just been a lesson within itself and something that I wasn't making time for as much prior to the past year. So that's what I'm learning. Embrace the simplicity and even repetitiveness. That's word.
It's great. Thank you. We have another question from Brianna, and you've sort of touched on this actually when Loren was asking just about your process. You know, you say you're a very visual person, but how would you say your process could translate into some advice perhaps? So she asked, you have any advice or lessons learned from your book writing experience for those who would also like to get into book writing? I think you mentioned beforehand when we were talking earlier that you might be working on your third. So what's your process and what advice would you give for those who are also looking into doing something similar?
Oh, yes. The advice I give is embrace all of your available senses. And what I mean by that is we all have different sensitivities and different things that awaken ideas or awaken memories. And some people, I'm not one of these people, but I know people like this, that's how they are with taste. They can taste certain spices and it like takes them back to childhood and helps them remember all of these things. So I don't think it's impossible to kind of sit down at a page or in a notes app and just write from scratch. But I do think that if you're able to kind of like incorporate other senses that make you think of things that you're interested in or even angry about or that you want to recall, I think that that can really get some really interesting stuff on the page. My rule is like whenever I feel stuck, I'm just like, get out and go live. And sometimes that's literally just opening like one of my coffee table books that just sits there. It's like, just open it and actually look at the pages, actually embrace the color, see what comes up for you. I think we all have that in different ways and we have to kind of figure out what those are. My sister is that way with music. Like music just, I mean, it just creates like a whole world for her and she can just hear a certain song and it brings up all these things. So yeah, I think it's a matter of finding out what that is for you.
That is such excellent advice. And even for somebody like myself, who is not maybe looking into getting into book writing, but who's been, you know, working from home for the past year and has been staring at a computer, right? Where that delineation between work and home is sort of very gray now, you know? And so being able to get outside and experience all the senses is so important and such great lesson for everybody.
Oh, well, thank you.
So thank you. Donna asks, do you have any writers or artists that you find inspiring that you perhaps draw inspiration from? We know nature is a great inspiration, but are there any other people in your life that you draw from?
Yes, yes. It's so interesting. I have this thing where I find out about an artist and they are almost always no longer living. So I feel like a lot of my artistic inspiration, like don't get to, you know, like email them and ask if we can get coffee one day, but you know, their stuff's still on the internet and I stalk them and find them. So some of them are Alma Thomas. She is was an African American abstract painter, which it is not easy to find abstract painters who look like me. And when I saw her work, I was just like, I'm a fan. And one of my favorites. Another favorite of mine is Carita Kent, who was a professor, social justice educator, and a Catholic nun. And she did some really fascinating things in her lifetime. Highly recommend checking her out. A sculptor by the name of Augusta Savage. She was African-American sculptor, and she has said something that I always have to remind myself of. And she talks about how, you know, my work, my legacy lives on through my students. And she was someone who created this beautiful sculpture for the World Fair, like back in the 60s or so, but they didn't pay her enough and she wasn't even able to take the sculpture home and it was destroyed. So I'm like, for someone like her to say that my work lives on through my students, even when we can't even go to a museum and see these sculptures, like, to me, that's like, I get chills even talking about that. So yeah, those are some of my favorites. I love finding, artists that maybe people don't know about as much and really kind of digging deep into their stories. So those are some of my favorites for sure.
They're great. I've been writing down the names and may need to follow up with you after. We have a question here from Nepal, actually. Kushal, thank you so much for joining us. Kushal writes, nature, trees, mountains, rivers, birds are among the first pictures a child draws as a kid. But when and how do you think we start neglecting this connection with Mother Nature? And is this pandemic been a good lesson learned for us? That is such a great question, Kushal.
Yes,
thank you.
That is a great question. And, you know, when I think about my own life, because I was nodding my head as you were saying that, I totally agree. I think for me especially, and I don't know if other people can connect with this, I think a lot of it comes from social pressure. I think the older we get, we become more aware of the social hierarchies, like, oh, this is what the cool kids do, or this is what is seen as successful. Like, grown-ups say wow to kids that do these things. And maybe even on a subconscious level, you know, we feel that pressure to kind of like set the childish things aside and, you know, pursue whatever our culture's idea of, you know, success is. And I think that can even affect our hobbies and our personal life, the things that we're interested in, because it's like, well, how is this productive or going to make me successful? So I definitely think over this past year and some change, you know, we've had to redefine what it means to be successful, productive, all those things. So yeah, I feel like for myself and many others, we're just starting to recognize that childhood thing that kind of got set to the side, and recognizing that that's still alive within us. And it's not too late to nurture that, even if it's just for fun.
Great. Thank you. And so we're kind of running out of time here, but I do have sort of one last fun question. You kind of got at this. Lauren asked if you had a favorite place or landscape, but we are World Wildlife Fund. And so do you have a favorite animal and why? Yes.
Oh my goodness. So for the longest time, my favorite animal has been dogs, because it still is. I actually don't have a dog right now, and I haven't had one for a long time, which makes me sad. But I feel like dogs for me represent like this kind of like extroverted positive energy that I don't naturally have myself. So I feel like I kind of like feed off of that, like, wow, you're just so energetic and happy for no reason at all. I need that in my life. However, tigers keep showing up for me, and I don't know what that's about, but I'm thinking about that more. And I'm like, is my favorite animal like kind of shifting, evolving? I don't know. So yeah, I think there might be something there.
Well, that's great. Thank you. And yeah, we're dog lovers and tiger lovers.
Yes. Oh, can I add one? I also love owls, but I'm simultaneously afraid of them. The ones I've seen, I'm like, okay, yeah, I love you from a distance, a lot of respect for you from over here. But yeah, that's another animal that for whatever reason, I think about a lot. So
yeah, that's great. Well, certainly owls show up in a lot of artistic work, visual art.
Yeah, for sure. I need to draw some.
But thank you so much, Morgan, and Loren too, for dedicating time today. Morgan, as I said, I'm such a personal fan, and now, of course, even more so. But you know, again, thank you for taking the time, and thank you to all of our audience members who tuned in. This now concludes our May 2021 edition of Pandas in Prose with Morgan Harper Nichols and Loren Mayor. So thank you so much for joining us. If you had family and friends who wanted to join but were not able to, we will be making this recording available on our website in the coming days on worldwildlife.org. So thank you so much again, and we look forward to seeing you next month at Pandas in Prose. And in the meantime, happy nature reading.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
So thank you so much. Thank you, Loren. Thank you, Morgan. We'll talk soon.
Thank you. Yes.
Bye.
Bye.